Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Third Line Grind. I'm Grady Little alongside Chris Caravelli and Hagen Nemsik at ION International Training Center. And today we are back with Adam Comrie for part two of his interview. In part one, we discussed his early hockey career, where he first got a love for hockey and started playing up in the Ottawa area, where he later moved down to the Northern Virginia area and progressed to have a long professional career. But today we're going to dive in a little bit more to his junior career and transition into his pro career as well. But as we get started, just as a little bit of housekeeping, I thought it'd be important to discuss the latest developments in the Brandon Leipzig situation, where he was having a private conversation with some friends through Instagram, said some very inappropriate things about some teammates, some misogynistic comments about women, and just overall, it's just an overall bad look for him and the Capitals organization. And having Adam alongside us, I thought it'd be good to get his opinion on what something like that does in a professional locker room, especially when he's been outed for saying things like calling his line mates losers. So Adam, welcome back to the podcast. Thank you for joining us again. But let's dive into it right away. What does this Brandon Leipzig situation do to a professional locker room like would be going on in the Capitals locker room right now?
Well, guys, thanks for having me back on the podcast. Thanks for all the listeners out there from all across the globe. I think a big part of the Leipzig situation is that there's no room for that in a locker room. I mean, yes, it's private and it should stay private, but I think there are things that shouldn't be said, even though you might think it. I know it's tough that it's a private conversation with him and his best friend, but it's tough to go into the locker room and you know, go to war with those guys that you were just saying that stuff about, because hockey being such a team sport, you got to grow and build and just be a good teammate. And I think that's a situation where, you know, you could have gone without saying that, and it could have done things differently.
Well, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head there where you talk about being a good teammate. You, like you said a couple of times, you realize it was a private conversation that got, you know, leaked out. But with that said, I feel like it's important for all our listeners, especially, you know, the younger ones that are youth hockey players and looking to make that next step in their hockey career, whether it's playing junior hockey or advancing from junior hockey to college hockey, et cetera, that the stuff that you put online, it lives forever. So there's always going to be that risk. So don't ever put anything out there online that you wouldn't want exposed to the public for this exact situation, where now this guy, you know, he said things in a group chat that were disgusting and inappropriate and people found out. Now essentially he's 25 and he's ruined his NHL career. I don't see how you come back from that with some of the comments that he made. But you know, I think this would be good to get, Chris, your opinion on, you know, players, kids' use of social media, whether, you know, good, bad, whatever, everything online lives forever. And, you know, as a coach, I feel like we can kind of look at that, and that can also sway our decision on picking a player for a travel team, junior team, et cetera.
Well, first of all, about the Leipzig situation, you know, this was a private conversation, so I don't put as much weight on it as I think everyone else in the media does. He may have been joking with his friends. It's not necessarily likely that he was, but he could have been. You know, we weren't involved in the rest of the conversation. I don't think the entire conversation's been leaked out, so there's not all of the context there. You know, I understand a guy like Leipzig in a locker room would be hard to stick up for. but I think the NHL and the Caps in particular could deal a little bit better with situations like this and be more consistent, right? Not that this is necessarily apples to apples, but, you know, if you look at Kuznetsov, at the Kuznetsov situation, you know, he does an illegal drug, right, cocaine, and gets only 4-game suspension. And then goes right back to playing on the first or second line for the Caps. And then you look at someone like Nate Schmidt, right, who used performance-enhancing drugs, supposedly, you know, unknowingly, And that's not an illegal substance. It's something that's banned by the NHL, but it's not an illegal substance to use, right, on the street, let's say. And he gets an 18-game suspension. So it's difficult to know where the line is. You know, is that fair? No, I don't think anything in life really is fair, but it seems like the proportion of how certain things are handled is different for each player. Right. Leipzig's a fourth line guy. He's quote unquote expendable. Right. They don't really need Leipzig. You know, Kuzi is a first or second line guy and, you know, presumably provides a lot more offense and speed coming into the zone and puck control. So he's a little bit more valuable. He doesn't get quite the same treatment as a fourth line guy. So, you know, I think from youth to pro,
a lot of coaches do their homework now online, right, on players, on not just articles on how they play or what other people say about them, but, you know, what their social media accounts look like, if they have Instagram or Facebook or anything like that. So all that stuff can get used sort of against you negatively, or it can get used to help. You know, it can be a help, you know, in your career. I think there's a lot of good things that can come from social media, a lot of positives, but then there are some negatives, right? If you put something up and someone takes a screenshot of it, you could maybe delete it, but then somebody's always got a record somewhere.
Exactly.
Of it being up there, you know, and with the world today, it seems like, you know, conversations that are meant to be private, they don't get respected like they used to, or they get leaked out and more people find out about it because of social media, right? You have people that have millions of followers online, and it can come back to bite you pretty hard.
Right.
Not necessarily, maybe it doesn't end your career, but it severely stunts it. And it definitely has a big potential of ruining it. Something I see on the youth levels, you know, a lot of kids now have cell phones, right? So yep. There's that inherent danger of like bullying, of group texts, or, you know, something gets taken out of context, or, you know, something gets said and taken the wrong way, or something mean gets said, and then everybody gangs up on somebody, and it can be, you have this sort of snowball effect. It's tough to nip that in the bud, especially as a coach, if you don't know about it, and then it gets to a point where it's so bad that you find out. Damage has already been done. So it's hard to come from behind in that situation to really make up for, you know, finding a way to get your team back together.
Right. And to build on that point a little bit more, I personally worked as a scout for a junior A organization for numerous years. But when I would be recruiting players, one of the things that I would do is I'd do my background on that player, and I'd see what kind of family they come from. And I'd also do my research on their social media to see what kind of stuff that are they posting. Are they posting pictures of them, you know, underage drinking at whatever party? Are they posting pictures of them? Are they dedicated to hockey? Are they, you know, posting pictures of them training, et cetera? Like what kind of content do they share? What's important to them? Because it is a window to your life. So you see those aspects that as a, you know, a scout, coach, et cetera, you'll see those aspects that are important to a player and that otherwise that player wouldn't necessarily show you. So you have to be very careful in that sense, because I guarantee you, as you advance through your hockey career, those coaches, those scouts, they will look at your social media profiles, and you do have to be very careful. It even goes into, what's your username? Is your username something that is family friendly, et cetera? And just keep your content clean, guys. It's just easy. It doesn't have to be this hard. It's very easily avoidable. And again, he made a mistake. Yeah, it was a private conversation that got leaked. But again, it was a conversation that shouldn't have been happening in the first place.
I think a big thing is, if you want to be a professional, be a professional.
So as you bring that up, let's dive into that a little bit more. I actually had that on my notes to get into it with you later, but since we have it on the forefront right now, let's dive into it. So like for you being a veteran professional hockey player now, you had 8 seasons in the AHL. You spent the past two seasons playing pro in Europe. So that's 10 seasons of professional hockey you have under your belt, let alone the three seasons in the OHL and season in the USHL. So to you, Adam, what does it mean to be a professional as far as waking up in the morning and then pursuing, you know, your professional goals throughout the day?
Well, everything's been pretty much the same for me my whole career. Summertime is a time to get strong and get better at your craft. Not saying that during the season it is too, but it's tough to play that many games and be able to be that strong throughout the season. So summertime is a time to continue with structure, and that's getting up in the morning and getting after your day, and that's working out and practicing every morning just to get the day going. And I think it's exciting to be able to wake up now and have the freedom to work out and get better, especially right now during this quarantine where you're not missing out of anything except if you don't do it at home. And I enjoy the process of getting better. And yeah, I played 10 seasons professionally, but I'm going to continue to get better and better. And a big part of getting better in my career is seeing guys like Michael Nylander. When I'm a rookie in Rochester, he's the first guy on the ice. He's working on something every day, and he's getting guys to come on with him so he gets somebody else better.
And so let me just interject for a second, Adam, if you don't mind. But to go back to give any listeners a background on who Michael Nylander is, if you don't know. But he was a longtime seasoned NHL veteran who, at the end of his career, Adam crossed paths with playing in the AHL in Rochester as Adam was on his way up. So Adam got a little bit of that that veteran leadership from Nylander. So Adam, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but just continue on. I want to get that background.
Yeah, so you see guys like that through your career, and that was a big eye-opener there when I first turned pro, is seeing a guy who's played in the NHL for so long and done so well, to see him getting out early on the rink before practice and working on something really makes you, especially as a rookie, to follow guys like that. And his leadership qualities were exceptional by, you know, just being a leader by example, and didn't really have to say much, but
well, I like that story that you just gave us too about Michael Nylander. As I was saying, he was a longtime NHL season vet towards the end of his career in playing in the minor leagues rather than playing in the NHL, but he still maintained that same work ethic to keep his skills sharp, to maintain his level of leadership. Whereas I've heard, you know, other stories, and I'll credit Spit and Chicklets for this, but they've told a story about Alexander Mogilny, the famous forward for the Buffalo Sabres, who ended up getting sent down to the AHL at one point, and he just walked into the coach's office and said, what's the fine for missing practice? And the coach said, it's like $1,500, something like that. So Mogilny wrote him a check for $15,000 and said, here's for the next 10 practices, and then walked out of the office. So it's clearly two different sides of the spectrum, and obviously one favors the other, but I really like that story of hearing somebody that was at the tail end of their career, but still working hard to maintain and make sure that they could stay at that level to play.
Right, and there's another example that I have of a guy you might know, Brett Burns,
who absolutely
plays for San Jose, one of the best defensemen in the NHL. He's a guy that would come to the gym before everyone with a gym bag of all of his toys for whatever he's got, plus all of his supplements. Guy was on the ball every day with his workouts, close to the trainer. Then there's a guy, you know, who's in the gym. So I got to see a guy who's in the gym working hard, who's also working hard on the ice. Then I see a guy who is working his bag off on the ice. So, you know, there's different places that guys need to focus on and get better at. And you see the professionals that are the best at their craft working on all the things that they need to improve.
Right.
And that's something that you don't like doing the stuff that is hard, but that's how you get the best, is you perfect your imperfections.
That's exactly right. And to go back to a coach that Ryan Blair and I were talking about in our last episode, Paul Mulvey, our midget AAA coach, but he was a huge proponent in telling us that to get, you know, this much better, and I know we're on a podcast, so I'm holding my fingers about 2 inches apart, but to get that much better, you have to put in that much work. And now I'm holding my hands about 4 feet apart. But, you know, there's nothing truer. And I feel like we're linear in seeing the way ways of a true professional, in that they're going to take care of their business no matter what, and they're going to keep that discipline that this steps A, B, and C are what's going to get me better, and I have to stay disciplined to them throughout the duration of my off season training, throughout the season, to maintain my body shape, etc. But Adam, let's dive back into your career a little bit more. We talked about your youth hockey experiences growing up in Canada, then moving down to the United States in the Northern Virginia, D.C. metropolitan area. We got into a little bit of that transition, what it was like when you moved down. But now let's jump into your junior career. So your youth hockey career ended at what, 15? And you jumped right into the USHL at 16 years old?
Yeah, so I was playing for the Montgomery Blue Devils with Coach Dan Houck. Shout out to Dan. He was a big influence on my career and moving forward, and a mentor for sure. So there was a guy by the name of Donnie Harkins who was the general manager of a new team in the USHL, the Ohio Junior Blue Jackets. And he came up to me at a tournament, and we were shaking hands after. And he gave me his card and said, come talk to me after. So I got to talking to him, and he wanted to draft me into the United States Hockey League. And at the next tournament, there's another guy that came up, and his name was his name was Ed Ward. He was an agent with Newport Sports Management. And later on, we could talk about how I met my actual agent, Wade Arnott, with Newport as well. So Ed was a big help in getting drafted to the OHL and to the USHL as well. So after getting drafted by both the USHL and the OHL.
So let me stop you there for a second. Let's rewind just a little bit, because I want to go into that recruiting process from making that step from Montgomery into the USHL. You just mentioned some names, but you also mentioned, and this is something I always preach to my kids, whether it's 18U, 16U, et cetera, is that you never know who's watching. So you were at a tournament, and you said that you were approached afterwards by a scout from USHL Ohio Junior Blue Jackets. And that's exactly my point, is that when you're at these tournaments, you never know who's watching you. You could have, there could be nobody there, or you never know who's dad, somebody, et cetera. So you always have to put your best foot forward and continue to play your game.
And that's with any interaction you make in the parking lot, in the locker room, in the lobby. Anywhere you make a connection, it could be somebody that's going to be influential in your career as a hockey player. So that's important, to be a good human in every aspect, on and off the ice. Because these managers and these scouts, and they all want good people on their team.
Right. So now let's dive back a little bit into the drafts. So you said you were drafted into both the USHL and the OHL. So just for a little background history, the USHL is the only quote-unquote tier one junior hockey league in the United States. It's the best level of junior hockey that you can play within the borders of the U.S. The OHL is what's considered major junior hockey and part of what's considered the Canadian Hockey League, which includes the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League and the Western Hockey League. So the three of them are all considered major junior. Once you play major junior, you do receive a small stipend for your services. So that does make you ineligible to play NCAA hockey. So Adam, you were drafted into both leagues, was it the same year?
Yep.
And then from that draft, did you have the opportunity did the OHL and USHL both offer you contracts to come play for their teams?
Yeah, so that was a situation in itself where I had to decide which route did I want to go. Did I want to go play in the USHL and be able to go to college or do I want to go to the OHL and turn pro earlier? And the OHL also plays more of a NHL-style season and structured a little differently than the USHL.
Right. So what went into your decision-making process? So obviously, those are two very heavy things to weigh when you think about getting, you know, free college education. And I remember from this recruiting process that you had received contacts from some very notable schools like Boston College, Boston University, you know, major Division I hockey schools. What, you know, weighed into your decision-making to jump to the OHL rather than staying that course?
Well, a big part of the decision for me after it was all said and done was my dream was to play in the OHL, because when I was a kid, I went to some games in Ottawa and I got to experience what a joy it is to be in the crowd and see those guys play in just such a cool environment. And it's the best... it's the best hockey players in Canada, so I thought that would give me more ability to be seen by scouts, because there was the top draft picks of my year playing in the OHL at the time.
Right, and we'll dive back into your OHL career a little bit more in a minute, but I want to talk a little bit about the USHL. So going into the USHL, you're 16 years old. Like I said, the USHL is notably the best junior hockey league in the country. So you're playing against some of the nation's top prospects that are upwards of 20 years old. What is that like as a 16-year-old? Did you go into it immediately intimidated, or did you have, you know, an internal confidence that you knew you belonged there?
Yeah, I don't think I was thinking too much at that age about being nervous, because it's just a game. Obviously, there's a lot of guys that were bigger and stronger than me, but I used my skating ability to get away from those guys that were trying to, you know, inflict some pain. But I think the biggest thing is just to work at your skill and know that you belong and enjoy, you know, being a young kid and looking up to those guys that have been there for a while, that are, you know, doing their job.
And what was it like for you leaving home at such a young age? 16 years old, you're, you know, still, what, a sophomore in high school at that point? And you make the decision to uproot yourself from your family, move to Ohio, where you're going to be billeted. And I remember you telling me about the situation in Ohio where you lived in, you know, it's, what, like Cleveland, and you had to commute to Columbus for practice?
Yeah, so... obviously, moving away at that age is a different feeling, because you're moving in with a family that doesn't run the exact way that your family does. So that's a whole another world of being accepted by another family and understanding their rules and how their family works. But the other part, which was tough, was just being so far from home. And we also had to bus to games in Columbus, because we lived in Cleveland.
And yeah, that was your home rink. So what, like, how far away was Columbus from Cleveland?
It was a two-hour bus ride, so everything was always a...
So it's your home games were a road game, essentially.
Yeah, everything was a road game that year. But I got traded in the middle of the season because we weren't doing so well, and I wanted to play on a team that was contending. And I went to Omaha in the middle of America, which was even further, but had a good time. I got to live with a veteran player, so he kind of showed me the ropes, which was very helpful.
Well, Omaha is kind of known for having one of the best fan experiences in the USHL. Would you agree with that? Was that kind of eye-opening? Because I know you told me, you know, in a one-on-one scenario about, yeah, you played in the same rink as the Columbus Blue Jackets when you were in Columbus, but once you got to Omaha, it's a smaller rink that would be filled to capacity every game. So what was that like as a 16-year-old, having rowdy fans and trying to deal with all of that?
Yeah, that was a really exciting transition to have that that fan experience with all these different teams out there in the West, Lincoln, Nebraska, Sioux Falls, Sioux City. It was a show, really, that they put on, and that was that was exciting to be able to be a part of it and live that dream.
So as you advanced on, you went, like we said, you went from the USHL to the OHL. And for those that may or may not know, the OHL is, in a lot of these smaller towns in Canada, like considered a professional organization and treated like one. So would your experience in the USHL, did that help prepare you for a little bit more of the fanfare that was coming towards you once you made that step to the OHL?
Yeah, it was definitely a nice stepping stone to be able to play in two different places in the USHL and experience what that was like. And the organizations were run really professionally, and I really enjoyed my time in the USHL, but you really notice the difference in the professionalism in the OHL and getting prepared for the next level, which is professionally. So the OHL definitely tends towards being fitting to go straight to pro while you play the same amount of games and it's structured the same, while college is only 30 some games and you also have to focus on schoolwork as well, which some people are more excited to do than others.
I'm taking you the latter on that. Awesome, Adam. So now you're in the OHL. When you were in the OHL, you played against some very notable names, most notably John Tavares, Steven Stamkos, P.K. Subban, Taylor Hall, Tyler Seguin. Do you have any memories of playing against guys like that that stick out to you?
Yeah, Stamkos has been doing the same thing his whole career. He's been taking one-timers. Tavares, same deal. He's been doing it forever. The hands are just incredible around the net. Yeah, Taylor Hall, super fast. I mean, all these guys. Wayne Simmons, huge, tough, strong.
Yeah, you were telling us a little bit before we got started today about a playoff battle that you had with Wayne Simmons way back when. It sounds like he hasn't changed his style of play too much, or he was big, rough and tumble and hard to move from in front of that net.
Yeah, and all these guys have kept their game the same, but they've just gotten better at the things that they weren't great at.
Right, and like these guys that you're playing against back then, could you tell they were on the fast track to NHL superstardom?
Yeah, your top guy on each team, you kind of knew if they would be something or not, especially because you're playing against the best players at that age anyway, so you can kind of see where they're going to go and how they react under the pressure.
Right. So now you've played, I want to say, 1 year in the OHL, and now you're draft eligible for the 2008 NHL entry draft. So prior to draft day, you attend the NHL Combine. Tell us a little bit about that. Like, what kind of physical testing do they do? What's the interview process like? A lot of times you'll hear these stories of these scouts or general managers asking these players these weird off-the-wall questions. Do you have a story like that or a question that you remember that you can share with us?
Yeah. Is there any way to cut this?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Okay, so I think this should be a next one because I can go into this forever. The whole Combine is like a whole podcast in itself. It's fucking wild.
Yeah. We can make it that way if you want.
Yeah. Because like the whole, like, I think getting drafted.
Right.
That's possible.
Yeah, I can.
Getting drafted.
Yeah, we're good.
Are we rolling again?
We are.
All right. And just to pick up.
I can go.
Okay, yeah, so you got the question. You know what it was?
Yeah.
All right.
So the Combine is a very intimidating experience. You show up, it was in Toronto, fly into Toronto for a couple days and get in your hotel room. You got a roommate.
Just to backtrack you for a second, how old are you at this point?
I'm 17.
Right, yeah, because you're a July 31st birthday, so you wouldn't turn 18 until after the draft. So you're going into this as a 17-year-old.
Yeah, so the first day you get up and you got a list of meetings and teams that you're going to meet with. Some of the teams are pretty serious. They got a camera set up and a whole crew. Some teams just have a couple scouts, and other teams have full setup. It all depends what room you're walking into and who's in the room. Each team kind of does things differently. Some guys are super serious and other guys you know, the first question is boxers or briefs. So they like to keep it light. I mean, you just got to be yourself, and everyone's human. That's the story at the end of the day, is everyone just, you know, wants to see what you're like as a character, see what you're like as a person, and they go about it in their own way. But after that,
can I stop you right there for a second and just ask you about that interview process? So, like we were saying, is NHL teams are notorious for asking some obscure off-the-wall questions. For example, I remember you telling me a story about you walking into an interview with a team at the Combine where the question was, you know, Adam, would you prefer to have a good poem or a loaded gun? And you're like, how do I answer that? And in reality, I think they're just looking to see how you can make up your mind. Are you going to be decisive and go with your gut feeling on that? Something like that. But was that kind of, you know, more or less the experience amongst a majority of your interviews? Or did other teams try to keep it light and just talk to you and understand who you are as a person?
Yeah, each team took it differently. Some guys had notes and questions that they wanted to ask for specific things. Some teams would just check you out as a person and ask you what you do with your free time or what you want to do. And it's cool that you can experience these guys like that are the best in the game, that are creating the best teams, and you find out what kind of organization they're like by the group in the room.
Right, you can kind of pick up on the team's culture depending on what they're asking, how their setup is, etc. So now you were saying you go into these interviews. What comes next after that?
So after the interviews, you get to go back and get a nice sleep, because in the morning you got to get up and you got to do the fitness tests. And that you put on your number plate and you...
Yeah, you're running a 5K.
You go through each station and you're basically in a rectangle. And in the middle of the rectangle is all the GMs and scouts watching you perform your workouts or your tests. So they see what they're trying to see is how hard you're going to work. Not necessarily how much you're going to lift or what they're looking for is that you will work and how you will work until what is your breaking point. And they look for that as a character. You know, what kind of character is this guy?
Right, and imagine also they look at the preparedness that a player comes in with. Do they come in shape? Are they ready to go? Are they at their peak physical health? Or did they kind of take the off season off and just kind of hang out and not physically prepare themselves for this combine? And I feel like that dictates, are they going to take their role on my or within my organization seriously? So what are some of the fitness tests that you had? I feel like the VO2 max is always pretty infamous, where you see the players on like the spin bike and they have, it's like a nebulizer in their mouth almost, and they're just told to pedal. Walk us through that. Like, what is that particular test like? You always see that spotlighted as probably the hardest one.
Yeah, where they drop the weight, a percentage of your body weight on the bike, and you got to push that bike as hard as you can for 30 seconds or a minute, and everyone's yelling at you and you're just pushing as hard as you can. And then right after, you go to this computer and you have to perform a test that you already did before leading up to the combine. So you can see how your brain works without exerting all that physical exercise. And then you can see how your brain works after you just are absolutely spent. And you can compare.
So is that for oxygen deprivation to see how, once you have something like that you're going to perform with your mental capacities?
Yeah, so what they're trying to figure out is how you perform after exercise or during exercise.
Right.
But the VO2 test is more just seeing how much oxygen you need to breathe and how much lactic acid you produce.
And so from there, you know, that, like you said, that's the most infamous test that you always see, whether it's NFL combine, NHL combine, whatever. But what are some of the other physical tests that they put you through?
Obviously the bench press, some vertical jumps.
So let's get into a little bit more specifics. On bench press, it's a set amount of weight for just
as
see how
many
you can go.
Yeah.
And what's the predetermined weight that they
I believe it's 155.
Okay, so 155 until you can't go any further, right?
Right.
All right, so you have that. Anything squat-wise?
I don't really remember, to be honest.
Just vertical leaps, eh?
Single leg, broad jump, double leg broad jump, vertical, a couple like speed drills in a ladder, speed drill in a box, single leg, a lot more agility stuff.
Okay. So once you go through the combine, what happens next? It obviously leads up to the draft. Going into draft day, obviously you're going to have a lot of correspondence with your agent. But did you have any preconceived notion on where you're going to go in the draft, who you're going to end up with, et cetera? Take us into, you know, that process leading up to the draft and what the draft day was like for you personally.
Yeah, so at the combine, my first meeting was with Florida. Unfortunately, I missed my meeting with them. I don't know exactly what happened. I read it wrong that it was at 8:30, but it was really at 7:30. So I called them and I said, I don't know what happened here, but I missed the meeting. They're like, no problem. Meet us at this time instead. I said, great. And when I met with them, I just felt like they wanted to take me, and that was kind of the thought between my agent and I as well.
So you got a good vibe from them right off the bat, even though, did you go with the AM, PM excuse? You set the alarm for PM rather than AM?
Yeah, that could have been it. I'm not sure which route I went, but definitely missed that meeting.
Wow. So that is who ends up drafting you. What a story, though. You end up sleeping through their meeting. Not necessarily sleeping, but you end up missing the meeting. And you still end up on their draft board and selected by Florida 80th overall in the third round. What was that feeling like when you get a call from your agent? Did the GM from Florida call you? What was that process like?
Yeah, so I remember the draft. The first round was at night, and I remember playing pickup hockey at Reston on the Olympic sheet and seeing the TV with the draft going upstairs, people sitting up there watching it. And then I went to bed, obviously anxious about the second round, third round, fourth, fifth.
Because there had been some talk that you could have potentially gone as high as a first round pick, right? At one point or another?
Yeah, there was definitely some talks, but talk is cheap. So.
Well, right, exactly. You know, things happen and, you know, players move up and down boards. But then, so you're selected on the next day of the draft. So was it more in what happened? And again, does the GM call? Who alerts you that you were just picked up by an NHL organization?
Yeah, so I was out rollerblading at my house, and then I decided to go back inside to see what was going on, and my dad's sitting there watching the draft, and then my name was picked, and 2 seconds later, I get a call from the GM, and
actually got to see it in real time on the TV. You got to see your name come up, and that's awesome. That had to be such a cool feeling, and you know what an awesome, you know, paramount for you as a person to see all your hard work through all those years of youth hockey finally, you know, pay off into being an NHL draft pick.
Yeah, it was definitely super surreal to see all the guys that I'm playing against get drafted and see where they go and what's next for their future. So it was cool to be a part of that group, and just to be drafted to the NHL is a dream come true.
Right, and I'd imagine that, you know, joy, I don't want to say that it's going to be short-lived because that's something you're always going to be joyful of, but, you know, that moment, I'd imagine, has to pass pretty quick because you're drafted and then you have to get to work immediately to become the professional that you want to be. So once your name's picked in the draft, what happens next?
Yeah, so just get an introduction to the Florida Panthers organization and what's next. And I head back to juniors for another year.
But going into that summer that you were drafted, you did attend their development camp and their main training camp, right?
Yep.
So going into that, I mean, were you being just still a young hockey player? Were you starstruck by anybody that you were skating around in camp with? I know personally, no matter what team I'd be with, I looked around and be like, oh my God, there's so and so.
Yeah, it was definitely cool to be in the locker room and on the ice with some of these big names like Brian McCabe and Wade Belak and Jay Bouwmeester.
Wow.
I think the biggest thing was seeing being Jay Bouwmeester's D partner after he comes off for a shift. He's barely breathing. The guy is just a machine, and that was eye opening there to see a guy who is so good at the game and works so hard that he has probably the best VO2 I've ever seen.
So skating with a D partner like Jay Bouwmeester, did that teach you more about being a professional and kind of backtracking to where we were at the beginning of the podcast, what it takes to be a professional? But he's somebody that I want to say he's 37 years old right now. And obviously, maybe not obviously for some of our listeners, but he went through a traumatic event at the end of last season where he collapsed during a game. So, you know, his future is in jeopardy because of that. But still, to be a 37-year-old playing at that level, he clearly has a high level of professionalism that he maintained throughout his career. And so being on a D-line with him, did you pick any keys up as to the mental side of the game, physical side of the game, or the on-ice part of it?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest parts about playing with him is that he was always talking to say what's going on. He was my eyes, and I just had to listen to what he would say and do it, and he would be happy. Come back to the bench, give you a little tap, say good job, and I think that's an important thing is being there for your teammates. You know, giving the guy a stick tap or pat on the back or, you know, just saying good job means a lot. It brings you confidence and helps everyone out.
Well, I think what you said on your partner being your eyes out there, I think that's really important for young players to hear. A lot of players like to talk in the locker room. They'll talk during practice, or they'll talk maybe on the bench during a game. But like when they're on the ice, it's real hard sometimes to hear people communicate.
Oh, yeah.
Our players communicate at the youth level. So I think knowing that if you can, your partner can see the ice well, your teammates see the ice well, they can communicate to you, they talk to you. It's just like a long conversation.
Yeah.
Right, being on the ice. So, hey, you know, one on, or hey, behind the net, or D2D, or whatever the cues are that you come up with on how to get that puck to your partner. But that, I think communication is something that lacks big time.
Absolutely. You want your other players on the ice to narrate the game almost, where play by play, you have the other members of your team, the other members of your line telling you who is where, who's open, who's on you, etc. And that's something that even if you're at an NHL game, you can hear those guys talking on the ice, even from upstairs in the top bowl. Come to one of our youth games, it's going to be dead silent. But I think that's a great point that you just added there, Chris. Let's see. But Adam, what's diving deeper into an NHL training camp, what's the daily schedule?
It's pretty jam-packed. I actually have some old itineraries from camps I've been to, but yeah, it's pretty busy. You're on the ice, you're working out twice a day, and you're doing some team building. It's a lot of eating, a lot of getting to know the guys, and you know, you think that some of these camps are super intense where you're, you know, doing drills for hours and hours, but you're doing basic stuff. You're just, you know, doing outside edges, inside edges, stationary passing. You're doing the fundamentals of hockey. And then you can, you know, scrimmage and you can do some drills, but a lot of it is just getting better at your craft and learning and having a skate coach come out and teach you for an hour. And then you get off and you do a workout and you learn how to truly lift weights like a professional. And some teams would take you to the grocery store and show you how to shop for groceries. You know, there's things like that that some kids need to see. And you know, what goes in your body is important because you want to perform at your best level. So these teams would bring in a chef to say, this is how you cook certain meals, or this is what you should buy at the store. And you just learn a lot at these camps because they're geared towards helping you grow as a human and as a hockey player.
I love that point too. Hanging around the rink here all the time, I'm sure the three of us can all attest to this, but we see our players here before practice eating mozzarella sticks before they go on the ice, right? And yeah, we get it. You're hungry. You're coming from school. Put something healthy in your body to fuel yourself. You're not going to get anything out of your practice unless you're at the top of your game. And if you made the commitment to be there, why not take something out of it, right? So I think that's a great point, Adam. Chris Hagan, I mean, can you attest to that too?
Yeah, that's a hard discipline to have when you're a kid. I think a lot of it comes from your parents. I mean, I remember growing up, my mom always made, like, you always had meat, you always had a vegetable, you always had, like, potatoes or something like that. We always had a really well-rounded meal, you know, growing up. I think that has stayed with me for a long time. Like, when I cook, it's pretty simple. It's just a little bit of meat, some vegetables, and
a lot of potatoes.
And barbecue, you know, potatoes. You gotta have barbecue sauce. I'm a barbecue sauce kind of guy.
Hey, and what about you?
I mean, yeah, pretty similar. I mean, my family, my dad was pretty strict on eating, so I was whatever, whether it was chicken liver at 10 years old or whatever, I had to eat, clean my plate.
To get dessert.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of, so I just kind of eat, like anything that's in front of my face. I mean, I definitely had a good diet when I was younger, have a good diet now. But yeah, I mean, I was always kind of fueling myself the right way. My dad was an athlete as well, so kind of just followed that trend.
Yeah, I think it's helpful. Your parents or whoever is, you know, whoever's making your meals when you're younger or whoever's in front of you that you're looking up to for guidance. It helps when they take those steps themselves. It kind of rubs off on you in a positive way for
right.
the most part.
Adam, let's dive back into your career for a little bit here. So we just talked about your first NHL training camp with the Florida Panthers. After that, you get sent back to junior for a year where you played for Guelph for a year, or is that your second year in Saginaw? Guelph? And then from Guelph, you bound, you made the next step up the following season to play with the Rochester Americans, the AHL affiliate of the Florida Panthers. So at that point, you're what, 20 years old now playing in the AHL? So this is a whole different beast where you have to, you're now a professional hockey player. You're making your own income. You have to pay for your own expenses. Was that kind of an eye-opening experience for you?
Yeah, to go get prepared though in the OHL, you're getting prepared for these things slowly, and that's getting used to the schedule and being able to go to school and play hockey. And instead of school now, it's you have to pay your bills, or you have to find a place to live and do your laundry and feed yourself and all these things that, you know, it's the first time and you're doing it away from your home in a different city where you have no parents or nobody to do it for you, so you have to do it yourself and take control of your life. So that was definitely a tough part of being a professional, but it was also a great learning process to be able to be independent.
On the church, so when you say that you had to do it, you know, figure out how to do this all in a different city. So looking at your HockeyDB page, once you got into the professional ranks, you did bounce around through a couple of different teams throughout your career. What was that like for you? Was it tough to make these adjustments from season to season, or, you know, hockey guys are hockey guys. If you fit in with one group, you're going to fit in with another.
Yeah, you notice even through juniors that you fit in with any team, and I'm known as a hockey nomad, moving around all the time and going to different teams. But I really enjoyed the places that I was able to see. A lot of upstate New York, which was beautiful, and central PA. It had been cool to see the West Coast, but now being in Europe, I'm thankful that I'm over there and enjoying that culture as well.
And in 2012 to 2014, you were with the Worcester Sharks of the AHL, the farm organization for the San Jose Sharks. Within that time frame, you got invited to the San Jose Sharks training camp where you were rostered to play in a preseason game. Tell us a little bit about that. You know, taking the big stage for the first time, it's a preseason game, but, you know, you're still out there with some really notable names.
Yeah, that was really exciting to be able to put a San Jose jersey on in a actual exhibition game. It was cool. We were playing the Anaheim Ducks, and we actually went into overtime 4-4, and we won, which was a bonus. But, yeah, it was a cool experience to be out there with Big Joe Thornton and Thomas Hurdle. And
speaking of which, you had an assist in that game, which were it was an assist to Thomas Hurdle on the goal with a secondary assist from Joe Thornton. That's a pretty cool experience in itself to get your name on an NHL score sheet, let alone being surrounded by Joe Thornton and Thomas Hurdle on it.
Yeah, they do say that Thornton is the best passer, and he rocketed a pass across the ice to the point, and I fed it in front to Hurdle, and he buried it, and just everyone just so good at all the little things, and that's being in front of the net, that's making a pass tape to tape, that's talking. It's all the little things that made that happen.
So you get a secondary, you get the primary helper on the goal to Hurdle with the secondary from coming from Thornton. Does he say anything to you afterwards? And if he does, what's that like? It's just expected that you're a pro, so you're going to make that pass no matter what at that level?
Yeah, no, nothing really. Just a couple stick taps.
Yeah. Take what you can get. I take a stick tap from Thornton anytime I can get it.
For sure. When you were playing with that with the Sharks organization, and when you had your call up for preseason game, was there anything that you noticed that you needed to really work on your own game, like from a hockey IQ perspective or from a skill perspective, like when you're playing with some of those big name guys?
Obviously, you see these guys that have way more skill than you and way more talent, but at the same time, they're working harder than you are. So obviously, there's a lot of things that I knew I had to work on, like my defensive game. But then you also see the things that you're good at. You know, shooting was really a big thing of mine that I always worked on and I was always pretty good at. So, you know, you come into those camps and you learn what you need to work on and you see what you need to work on because you see the other guys that are doing it better than you.
You spend 8 seasons in the American Hockey League and then you sign with Klagenfurt of the Austrian Hockey League. Talk us through that decision. What's that like deciding to leave North America, play hockey on a different continent?
Yeah, it was always a thought in my back of the head that I wanted to go there. But finally, I made the leap, and it's the best decision I've ever made. I really enjoy the hockey over there. The culture's amazing. I thought that I was moving around too much in North America, not really getting a shot at the NHL level. I was just kind of bouncing around the East Coast and the AHL. So I decided to head to Europe, and I picked a great place to play. In my first year, we were fortunate enough to win the whole thing. And
how'd that happen?
So I went back.
for those of you listening, Adam was, he's being modest here, but when he says they won it all last season, he scored the game winner in overtime of the championship series to seal the deal. So that had to be a wild experience. But Adam, tell us a little bit about the differences between the professional game in Europe as opposed to North America.
In Europe, there's a bigger ice surface. We're playing an Olympic sheet. There's less games. We only play 54 games a year. You're only playing basically Friday and Sunday games, sometimes the odd Tuesday. So it's nice that the games are all spread out, so you're not playing 3-and-3s where that third game is just a dump and chase kind of gig. And it's a little less physical because there's more ice and there's more speed. Guys aren't as big, so it's definitely less physical.
As far as like coaching, did you see any major differences between how, you know, players would train in North America as opposed to Europe and how the coaches would treat and train their players both on and off the ice?
Yeah, there's definitely a different culture to the players in Europe, but it's just great to be able to be over there with a different culture and learning a different way of coaching. And I'm fortunate enough that I got to help coach one of the teams and also a bunch of five-year-olds. So I was able to be a coach as well over there and continue teaching while I'm there.
That's a lot of fun. I mean, is there anything like specifically that you can speak to that would be like major differences in how practices were run? Do they, you know, like the U.S. Development model, they stress small area games, things like that. Is that something that would also be dictated into practices at the youth level over in Europe and also at the pro level?
Yeah, I think when you look at it in the big scheme of things, everyone's teaching the same concepts. Not necessarily the small details, but if you look at it in a broad view, you're seeing everyone teaching the same core concepts throughout the world, I'd say, not just Europe and North America. I think everyone's kind of learning the same way and learning from each other and what tools to coach with.
Yeah, I think the game's evolved a lot, right, in the last, say, 15, 20 years, right? From when we were growing up to play the game, you know, dumping the puck in the zone was huge.
Oh, yeah.
Cross ice dump or rim around. A lot of times now, games, you know, your coaches want you to carry the puck in. It's a more successful zone entry if you have possession of puck while you gain the blue line, right? So we see a lot of that, I think, in North America and across the globe.
Yeah, and you're getting all the analytics from every single player. So you're getting all the numbers, and if everyone's getting all the numbers, they're trying to figure out which to go by, and everyone's getting the same stuff. So you got to teach along that information.
Going into some of the analytics, does your team, Klagenfurt, do they provide you with like a spreadsheet or data points on your zone entries and zone exits and successful breakups and things like that at your professional level?
Yeah, so after every game, we'll get a email and it'll break down the whole game. You can watch all your shifts on it. You can see how much time on ice. You'll see every single statistic and number you can ever imagine that you need.
That's awesome.
Will be in a in a email on your phone. You can look at it on the bus. You can watch your shifts clip by clip.
So how often do you use that during games that you know, or you have a feeling that, I mean, you're a professional hockey player, so you probably know when you have a good game and when you don't, when you have not such a great game. How often do you look at the video in general? And then when you have, say, a really good game, do you not look at the video? When you have a bad game, do you look at the video more?
I enjoy looking at the video no matter what, good or bad game, because sometimes you can think that you had a really good game and then watch the video and realize you didn't have a good game.
Yeah.
Then you can have the opposite. Or you can just say, you know what, I want to watch the game because I think I can figure out a way to beat this team, how they play, how are we going to do, you know, our system to beat this team, or what can I do better against these certain players? And then you learn what teams and what players do what. Then you can kind of say, okay, get mentally prepared for that team that next night.
Yeah. And are there coaches that that take you through your own game film or like team film?
So we go through film almost every day. So we're watching a clip or 10 or 20 every day, just depending on, you know, how things went or what time in the season it is. If it's early in the season, you're watching a lot more video. Towards the end, you're watching a little less. But I love video because then you can see how your gap is or what you think you saw or what you didn't see, and you can see that. And next time you will find yourself with more space and more time because you saw yourself with that extra space or without that extra space.
Yeah, it's interesting to see yourself removed from the situation, right? It's sort of like that bird's eye view of like, all right, okay, you know, when you're only looking through your own blinders, you see from one perspective, but to take it from another perspective really broadens your view, I think, on like what you're saying, you close your gap more, or, you know, I had more time than I thought.
Or if you know, you're looking to shoot, but you should have passed or to see how open that guy was or wasn't. Or if you make a pass and it doesn't go through, you can see kind of your better angles and you understand the game more. And you can see if your gap's not good, you can just move up a little bit and be more comfortable out there knowing that you can be up that close. So there's definitely things that you can take out of video each time, no matter if you feel like you're great or if you're terrible.
Well, it shows you what your coach sees as well. So in certain aspects where you're talking to players on the bench, and if you're getting a rebuttal from that player and the player goes and looks at the video doesn't lie. So it gives you that perspective as well. But Adam, I know we've been going with you for a while here. So to wrap up, just tell us what you're planning to do to train this summer to prepare for the next season.
Yeah, so I'm already about 8 weeks into just working out off the ice and getting my body back to alignment. So I'm going to continue working out at home. And once everything opens up again, start skating and get into a routine where I'm working out and skating at least 5 days a week and getting into that hockey mindset towards the end of summer where I can really get into a groove and get into a flow for the upcoming season and be prepared as much as I can physically. And also a big important part is to be sound mentally.
I was trying to walk you into a simple answer, which was going to be you were going to be skating with us to train this summer. But anyways, I guess your answer will do.
Where else would I skate?
But thanks for tuning in this week. Adam, thank you very much for your time. We greatly appreciate having you.
Guys, thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here.